All right, I think we're ready to go. Good afternoon. I am Pam Marcucci. I'm the Director for Program Development and Outreach here at the JI. So I have a question for you to start this afternoon. Can anyone here tell me what hydrocephalus, concussion, heart valve replacement, balloon catheter manufacturing equipment, femoral access, diagnostic imaging, 3D printing, transseptal punctures, and the mechanics of flow have in common? Okay, well, they're all topics with which our interns over the years have become deeply familiar in the course of their summer internship programs. It's an eclectic combination, but it's one that represents the transdisciplinary mix of specialties that's found here in this building. I'm pressing the buttons up here. I have to close this. So, in fact, the building is founded on the idea that by bringing different medical specialties and scientific disciplines together, we can do things that no one discipline or specialty can do alone. So, thank you for coming to the fourth JI College or First Gen Internship Presentation event. I call them First Gen Interns to differentiate them from our Next Gen Interns who graduated last week. So, this is the fourth year of the First Gen program. And I'm very happy to see some of our alumni in the audience from past programs. If we were to quantify the work that goes into each 9-week internship program in terms of JI person hours, so this would include the time that Allison spends writing and posting the intern positions, answering questions and vetting applications, the time Mike, Allison, and I spend reading applications and interviewing candidates, the time the entire JI staff spends identifying potential projects for each intern and then mentoring the interns during their 9 weeks here at the JI. Not to mention the time our leadership and others from the BNMC spend with them sharing their knowledge. It would add up to a staggering number of hours. So why do we do it? Well, we do it for some more self-serving reasons, and then we do it for some reasons going back to giving to the community. So on our more self-serving side, our summer internship program helps us identify future employees. So far, and this has only been 4 years of the internship program, so far we've hired 4 former interns for various periods of times. And I have no doubt that this trend is going to continue. So our summer internship program also increases our institutional productivity. We're a very small team, and we benefit from short-term additional person power and from the novel perspectives they bring. So thank you, Matt, for reminding us that not everything needs to be 3D printed. The interns energize us and allow us to take on projects that we don't necessarily have the in-house expertise, remember, transdisciplinary approaches, or the time to do ourselves. So on the intern and community side, we believe that our summer internship programs help shape the next generation workforce for Western New York and beyond. Our interns emerge with substantial real-world experience and professional networks that enhance their value as students and employees. Evidence of this lies in the fact that all of our former interns are employed in school or purposefully figuring out how to best make an impact. It also lies in the fact that most of these interns are still in touch with each other and with the Jacobs Institute. We also believe that our internship program shows future generations that there are job opportunities here in Buffalo. One intern told us that when she'd gone away to school in Cleveland, she didn't expect she would come back here after graduation. After doing the internship program, she said, well, actually, no, I might consider coming back to Buffalo. There's such a vibrant vibe going on in the BNMC. So we believe that our internship program is unlike any other for several reasons, a couple of which I will mention here. First, we assign projects that correspond to each intern's individual skill set, but that also represent something that we need at the JI. This ensures that the interns are an integrated part of our team and that their success in producing their concrete deliverables is also our success in getting done what we need to get done. Second, we have final project presentations that are just as much part of the deliverable as the deliverable itself. We believe that having good ideas is often not enough, and the ability to communicate them is often overlooked. So we're excited to see you here. We're excited to have you here today to see our 2017 interns present their projects. We'll miss them and are grateful for the knowledge that they've shared with us this summer, but we're happy to note that they're all coming back for lunch on Monday. And also to remind you that, as with all the other interns have found, once an intern at the JI, you can check out anytime you want, but you can never leave, et cetera. So after the program, please join us across the hall for some refreshments and some mingling. And now, without further ado, I have the pleasure of introducing our 2017 interns, Tessa Oyama, a rising biomedical engineering senior at the University of Buffalo, Brett Basinski, a rising electrical engineering senior at UB, and Matt Donovan, a rising mechanical technology senior at NCCC.
So just be one moment. We have to pull our presentation back up. All right. All right. Hello, my name's Tessa. So who here has played a sport? Who here knows somebody who's played a sport? Good. So this presentation is going to apply to basically everybody in this room. So concussion. Besides from a really good Will Smith movie, what is it? Well, a concussion is a type of brain injury that happens when you hit your head on something and your brain bounces around inside of your skull. It can cause your brain tissue to stretch, compress, and it can cause some of the brain cells to die. It can come with a various amount of symptoms like impaired reaction time, headaches, nausea, balance problems, dizziness, you name it, it's probably on the list. But what does this have to do with the Jacobs Institute? I mean, this is a vascular center. We study vascular disease. Well, concussions have actually been shown to be a risk factor for stroke, which, when you think about, might not make a lot of sense. I mean, you think concussion, you think high school or college football player, and you think of stroke, you might think of a little bit older age group than that. But when you think about it a little bit more, it does actually make sense. When you hit your head and you have an impact zone, you can cause a blood clot that in later time can shoot up into your brain and cause a stroke. If you already have a plaque buildup within an artery, once you get an impact by that site, it can cause it to loosen up, and then at a later time, it can go up into your brain and cause a stroke as well. And this is a problem because there are a lot of concussions every year. It's actually estimated by the CDC that there are 3.8 million concussions every year. And this number only really accounts for sport-related concussions in which somebody loses consciousness. And only 1 in 6 of these concussions is actually diagnosed. So what can happen if it doesn't go diagnosed? Well, one thing that can happen, a patient can get post-concussion syndrome. This is basically when somebody's symptoms from a concussion don't alleviate over time. So they might go on for weeks to months to even years after the injury. And I know this firsthand. I played volleyball for 10 years, in which time I sustained 4 concussions, the last one that was actually career-ending. But that concussion was 16 months ago. And today, I'm gonna tell you that I still have some symptoms. I had a sleep study that showed that without medication, I wake up 13 times an hour. I still have chronic migraines, and I do get a headache every time it rains, so I am basically a weatherman. I also have some memory problems, so if you see me stumbling around trying to find my car after this, it's okay, I'll find it even if it's in the morning. So my symptoms are all gonna go away. And so that's pretty cool, I guess you would say. But for other people, they might not be so lucky. Chronic traumatic encephalopathy is a degenerative brain disease that has an onset of time that can be months to years to even decades after your last concussive hit. It's basically when your brain cells die off, and its signature is a deposit of tau protein that's specific to this condition. It's going to come with a lot of different symptoms. At the beginning, you might have headaches, you might be a little confused sometimes, but by the end, you're most likely gonna have dementia, problem-solving skills, you might not remember things at all, you're gonna be aggressive, and you're basically not going to be yourself. And this condition is basically a death sentence because there is no cure for it and you can't reverse it. You can do things to help slow down the progression of the symptoms. You can play a lot of puzzles to try and help your memory, but other than that, there's not a lot that you can do. You may have heard about this condition because of the NFL. They recently released a study that showed that 110 out of 111 of the NFL players that had passed away and donated their brain to the brain bank did test positive for CTE. But that obviously is not representative of the entire NFL population. There have been 1,200 other former NFL players that have passed away since the beginning of this brain bank. But even if we were to assume, which is completely unlikely, that every single one of those players were to test negative for CTE, that still means that 9% of all NFL players have CTE by the time that they pass away. An example of this is Brian Price. He played for the NFL for a number of years. He was a loving father, loving husband, and I'm going to tell you a little story about him. So one time, he was sent out by his wife to go get a massage for his birthday. Sounds nice, right? But he ended up at an auto repair shop. He was confused. He was disoriented. He was being aggressive to customers. They couldn't make out his words very well. So they called the cops because they assumed he was a deranged man on drugs. And the cops came. They tried to calm him down. They thought he was on drugs, but he wasn't. He was taken to the hospital. So what can cause somebody that is not on drugs to do this? He launched himself through a glass door. And he's a 300-pound, 6-foot-1 man. That's a force that goes through there. So he's suspected to have CTE. And that is really the only explanation for that, except for they can't test for it until after you pass away. So the effects of this you're not going to see for, what I said, months to years to decades afterwards. But there is a condition that can affect you within minutes. This is second impact syndrome. This occurs when you have an impact to your head after you already have sustained a concussion. It causes dysautoregulation of your vasculature, and it basically causes your brain to fill with blood at an alarming rate. It has a 50% mortality, that means you die, and almost a 100% morbidity, which means you have lasting lifelong effects. You can see on the left here, if I go back, this is a normal, healthy brain. On the right, this is a brain that has been subjected to second impact syndrome. This is the blood that is pooling through the brain. And an important thing to notice here is the midline shift. This line is supposed to be in a straight line in the center of your skull. So this shows that there's so much pressure on the brain that the entire thing has moved over. So I'm going to tell you guys about Zachary Lestat. He was a football player. He was 13 years old in middle school. He had a tackle. He was taken off of the field after complaining of a headache. And his trainer looked at him, evaluated him, and sent him back into play. And a few minutes later, he had another hit. And this was him a couple months later in a coma. He had a double craniotomy to try and alleviate the pressure in his brain. And he was lucky he lived. So 3 months later, he woke up from a coma. 9 months later, he said his first word. And today, he changed history. So him and his family worked together to create the Zachary Lestat Law that basically states that if a player has a concussion, they are legally not allowed to get back in the game without being cleared by a medical professional. But Zach was looked at by a medical professional. And that brings us to what I did this summer. I was tasked with looking at the concussion epidemic as a whole and to provide a meta-analysis of the prevention, the diagnosis, and the treatment of concussions and all of the latest research that's been done. So the first thing I did was look at prevention. And you think of concussion, that's your brain, which is in your head. So you think head helmet, right? So I looked at helmets, lots of them. And basically what I found is that there is not a single helmet that is available in the US that can prevent your head from getting a concussion. Helmets are actually designed so that they protect your skull from fracturing, which can cause your brain to hemorrhage out. So helmets do save your lives, so still wear them, but they will not protect you from a concussion. And then I had the opportunity this summer to talk to a lot of different professionals. I got to talk to Dr. David Poulsen, who is a neuroscientist. I also had the opportunity to talk to Dr. Renee Reynolds, who is a neurosurgeon. And after talking to them, I had the opportunity to kind of decide where there were real gaps in this issue. And we kind of decided together that there really needs to be a better diagnosis method. Because as I've shown you guys, it's really the second, third, fourth hit that really has a lasting impact on people's lives. I also had the opportunity to create a brochure, which I'm sure you've all seen in front of you. We're going to be able to hand these out to everybody that comes through our brain boot camp at the Jacobs Institute. Now, we see about 700 high school, middle school students every year, and so these brochures are going to help to educate them on the effects of concussions, what to do if they think they have a concussion, and the importance of new diagnosis methods. So let's look at what's wrong with the ones we have now. Well, they're subjective, to say the least, and they're not completely effective, and it's really hard for trainers to diagnose them. I mean, concussions are an invisible injury. If you break your arm, you're going to know it's broken because you're going to see it on an x-ray. If you roll your ankle, you're going to know because your ankle is going to be the size of the softball. But concussions are different because they are invisible. You can't see them. They're inside of your head. And besides somebody telling you that they have maybe a headache, you're not really going to see much. This is the most widely accepted test that we have for concussion today. It's called the impact test. Basically, it's on a computer. It's going to ask you about 22 symptoms that you'll self-report. It's also going to take you through things about reaction time, your memory, problem-solving skills, and that's going to be your baseline test. You're going to take that test before you even step foot out onto the court or onto the field. If they suspect that you may have had a concussion, they're going to sit you down and make you take the test again. And then they're going to evaluate the difference between these tests, which in theory works, because if you have a concussion, you're going to perform worse. But sometimes it doesn't work. There have been studies that shown that up to 25% of collegiate football players don't perform well on the first test on purpose, because they know that if they get a concussion, they will be taken out of the game. And of course, we've seen what can happen, but everybody's taught from the time their feet hit the ground that you play through injuries, right? So we're going to look at new diagnosis methods, because we need one that's definitive. We need to take out the subjectivity and the judgment calls. We need something that's going to be portable so that we can take it to the court and field, and something that's going to be fast. So one of the things I looked at was blood-based biomarkers. Basically, what happens when you have a brain injury, things are going to be released into your blood that are only going to be there if you do have a brain injury. So we're going to be able to draw some blood, run a little bit of tests, and it's going to be able to tell you between the two biomarkers that I have listed up there, up to 94% sensitivity that you do have a concussion or you don't. Another thing that I looked at was oculomotor assessments. Basically how this works, when you have a concussion, your eyes may not work together like they should. You might have a problem doing smooth tracking, so if you're following a line from point A to point B, you might not be able to stay on that line. Your eyes might not work together, so one might travel at a different shape than your other eye. And how this device works, it's a pair of goggles. They're virtual reality-like goggles. So you put them on, and it's kind of like the goggles that you see at a video game store. And you're going to follow a dot around in a circle. And within 60 seconds, a report is going to print out, and it's going to have numerical data to tell you how well you performed. And if we have any STEM people in here, you know that numbers don't lie. And this device is completely portable. So you can take it in a briefcase, on a bus, to a court, on a plane, basically anywhere. So where are we now? Well, the oculomotor assessment devices have been cleared by the FDA, and they're currently in clinical trials with all of the Pac-12 football teams. So within a couple years, I think that they'll be ready to really make a huge impact on this matter. The blood tests, they're still in the beginning stages of research, so they have not had clinical trials yet. It's also not portable right now, so this blood test does have to be administered in a clinical setting, so it's not quite ready to really make an impact all over the country. So why did I do this project? Well, it's obviously a matter that's very close to my heart, and the great thing about the Jacobs Institute is that we look at patient outcomes on every aspect. Whether it's from surgical planning to device testing, the end game's always the same. we want to have a better patient outcome, no matter if it's in downstairs in the lab or in the operating room, if it's for devices that for companies that we work with, we really just want a better outcome. So my colleague Matt, who also worked on something along these lines, also has a project, and I would like to pass the mic to him.
When I was a kid, maybe 10 years old, I remember my grandfather brought me to the Canadian Heritage Warplane Museum. I'm sure a few of you have been there before. It's a really cool place. Now here they happen to have some flight simulators where two pilots can hop on and, you know, fly in a simulated dogfight against each other. Now my grandfather is a pilot. He has been for many, many years. He owns his own plane. All of his friends own planes. So I think it's fair to say he's kind of an expert in this field. So that should come as no surprise then. He was completely baffled on how his 10-year-old grandson outflew him. Well, it was pretty simple why. I had a flight simulator at home. Now, I know that you're wondering, well, how do flight simulators and medical simulators, what do they have in common? Well, it's pretty easy. They both make you practice something, and by practicing, you're gonna get better. When I got to the JI, I was told to create a femoral access model. Now, a little bit about femoral access is it's pretty much the beginning of every endovascular surgery. In order to get their tools up into the heart, the brain, or wherever the surgeon has to, you know, do their work, they need to safely get inside of an artery first. And the femoral artery is a great spot to do this. As you can see, it's a pretty straight shot up to the brain, into the heart. Now, before I get into my project, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the JI. The JI has an amazing access to information. Above us are some of UB's smartest researchers. And below us in our cath labs, we have some of the best vascular surgeons in the world. And in the JI, we have the most brilliant engineers I've ever had the pleasure of working with. We also happen to have a state-of-the-art 3D printer on site. Now, we can use this 3D printer to create a lot of different things. We make models for visualization. We make some models for pre-surgical planning. And then my favorite are the models that we make for device testing. Now, these models, we can actually put real products in and try them out. They feel almost identical to humans in terms of the feedback that they provide, the ways that the device actually behaves inside of it. Even how they look under X-ray is incredibly realistic. So we're actually the only United States Stratasys Center for Excellence in Healthcare and 3D Printing. Now, this should tell you that our models aren't good. They're absolutely great. I'm not here to toot our own horn, but toot toot. So now, our models can teach a surgeon a lot, obviously, but there is a gap. They don't really have a way to practice how to get into the femoral artery. Now, there are a few models out there, such as this one, the Syndaver, which, you know, could do this. But one of the problems here is this is going to set you back about the price of a luxury vehicle. So I'm sure you're wondering, well, how do they practice this surgery? Well, they use a method called the Halsted method, created by Dr. William Halsted. And this goes like this. See one, do one, teach one. Now, I'm not sure about you guys, but if I knew that the surgeon hadn't actually done this procedure before and they'd just seen one, I'd be a little bit nervous. Actually, scratch that, I'd be really nervous. So a little bit about myself. I'm a community college student at Niagara Community College. I'm studying mechanical technology as well as computer-aided drafting and design. During my time here, I actually had the privilege to study under Professor Mark Boisenay. Professor Boisenay wrote the book on SOLIDWORKS, and this is the industry standard for CAD software. He encourages all to get out in the world and see engineering in the works, and that's how the JI and myself first made contact. Now, I had heard about 3D printing at the JI, and I knew they were doing great things. I really wanted to see this, so I figured, well, I'll just stop in, walk up, you know, ask some questions. I told a few people about this, and they all thought I was nuts. They said, this is a hospital, it's a research facility, you can't just walk in there. Well, Professor Voisinet had a little different outlook. He said, yeah, go for it. What's the worst they can say? No. So I did. Now, when I got to the JI, I happened to walk into Mr. Mike Springer, our director of operations and entrepreneurship. We spoke for a little bit about my schooling, what I was into, the JI 3D printing, and he told me about the internship program that they offer here. He actually said that I should apply for it. Now, first thing I thought is there is no way that a community college student such as myself would ever be able to get into this ultra high-tech medical research facility. Well, thankfully, I was wrong. The JI has this amazing ability to see a person's passion, their potential, their ambitions, and they saw something special in me. So long story short, here I am. Now when I got to the JI, the first thing I had to do was figure out why. Why do we need a femoral access model? Why is this so dangerous? Well, I did a lot of research, I talked to some doctors, I spent some time down in the cath labs, in the operating room, and I finally got some answers. Now this procedure presents a unique set of complications. Some of these include, such as this one, poking through the backside of the artery, completely missing the artery altogether, or gaining access into the vein instead of the artery. Now, I also learned that the closure devices that they use can present some pretty unique complications as well. This one here is called an angioseal, and it works kind of like a rivet gun. Part of the tool goes inside of the artery, and another part smushes the hole into the middle, and this will eventually dissolve in your body. But if it's not used correctly, the part that is inside the artery here with the with the blue arrow by it, that can actually float down your bloodstream into your leg and cause a blockage somewhere. And I don't need to tell you why that's bad. So we had the why figured out. Now we moved on to the how. How do we 3D print a surgical training model? Well, the first thing we had to do was see the materials that we could print. So we printed out some samples. We put them next to some actual tissue samples, and it was pretty quick to figure out that they don't feel quite the same. So we started looking into other materials that we could use. We actually looked to Hollywood. Now, Hollywood makes some pretty convincing fake body parts, so it seemed reasonable to see what they were doing. And they seemed to all be using silicone. Now, I continued some research and happened to stumble upon a study that was done for deep tissue injury in patients that were in wheelchairs and bedridden. Now, this study had an extensive amount of data about the mechanics of human tissue, as well as the silicone, the same brand and formulas that we were looking at to make this model out of. I was also really happy to find out that all these silicones were well within the ranges of actual human tissue. So we had our material figured out. We had a production process figured out. The next step was to design the model. So what we did is we started with a patient CT scan, as you can see here. And we segmented out the parts we needed. So this would be the bone, the muscle, the arteries, the fat. And segmentation is just kind of a fancy word for saying pulling out what you need. How the software works is, as you can see, the bone here is bright white. You'd be able to select that brightness, that intensity of it, and then subtract everything that's less bright or more bright. And what you're left with is just what you need. Some of the software we used for this was called Vascular Modeling Toolkit and 3D Slicer. Now, while this works well, what you're left with is a model with a lot of holes in it, rough edges, pretty much unusable. So next we would bring it into a program called Mesh Mixer. Mesh Mixer allowed us to fill all these holes, it allowed us to smooth the edges, and make sure that generally everything fit together properly. After we were satisfied with our results here, we then brought it into SolidWorks. Now in SolidWorks, we could build our base, check all our measurements, and make sure that everything was just about perfect. And finally, we were ready to 3D print. Now, I learned about 3D printing several years ago at the Buffalo Public Library. They have a 3D printer that anybody's allowed to go in there and use. So I already knew that, you know, this might be an option. Now, at our school's 3D print lab, we actually have the exact same printers that they use here. So I was well aware of their capabilities and their limitations. So this seemed like a great opportunity to save some money. Now, there was one particular part about our model, the base, that it didn't need the ultra-high accuracy that our in-house printer can offer us, and it didn't need the multi-material capabilities either. So this seemed like a great opportunity. We went there, we printed it out, and we had great results with it. More importantly, we actually printed this model for about $22. So if we would have done it here, it would have been roughly $400. After we had all our pieces printed out, we had to go on to making molds of them. Now, this process was pretty simple. We cut out some acrylic, and if any of you have ever worked with acrylic, you know it's a real pain. Once we had our acrylic cut out, we started building boxes. And when we got these boxes, we would take our 3D printed models, such as this one here, and we would lay this down inside of the box. Next, we would cover it halfway up with the clay, and you can see that on the pictures we have here. And then finally, we would pour silicone over top of that. Now, when the silicone cured, we could flip it over, pull out all the clay, and then pour on another layer of silicone. This allowed us to create two-piece molds that we could actually make the body parts out of that we needed, so the muscle, the bone, the fat. And here are some of the products that we actually got out of it. This would have been one of the muscles and the base and bone, obviously. Now, we had to make the vasculature, but we used a completely different process for that. And unfortunately, the process was difficult. It was really hands-on. It was messy. It was unrepeatable. So this is where the beauty of the Translational Research Facility really shines. We were able to just kind of talk amongst ourselves, and actually Tessa really helped me out with this one, in designing a tool that would allow us to create these arteries and veins easily, quickly, and with the same results each and every time. Now, this tool actually worked quite well. As you can see, we have some of the original ones that we tried making by hand, and they don't look so good. And then we have some of the arteries that we actually made with the tool, and they came out great. So now we had our veins, we had our arteries, we had pretty much everything. We had to make the skin now. Now, the skin was actually the easiest part. And to do this, we used a few different types of fabric and silicone and then just kind of layered them together. And to be honest with you, we had some pretty good results. So finally, we had our entire model made, and we were ready for some testing. The picture on the right here would be the model without the fat and the skin. And we were lucky enough to have Dr. VJ Iyer, one of the premier cardio structural heart surgeons, actually do some testing on it. Now, we got down to the why. Why do we need this model? We already know why. What does this model do? Well, what this model does is it attempts to act human. And it does this several ways. It tries to look human. It has the right color, the right shape, the right texture. The crease is right. It just looks human. And actually, under an x-ray, you can see the bone just like you would. The next part was the feel. The feel was very human. The way that you could put the needle in and pull it out, if you touched it, it just felt like flesh. But most importantly, it had a pulse. Now, the pulse in this procedure is kind of like radar. The surgeon can't see the artery. He doesn't know where it is, so he's relying on his sense of touch and his general knowledge of the human anatomy. So now he has the needle in. How does he know that he got to the artery? Well, to do this, they watch the blood flow. Now, if there's no flow coming out of the needle, then they didn't hit anything. If they accidentally hit the vein, you're going to see a smooth, linear flow of blood coming out of the needle. But if they hit the artery, it's a very distinct pulsating motion or flow of the blood coming out. Now, this is a part that our model excels at because we can use multiple pumps, one for that pulsating flow in the artery, and then another one for the smooth linear flow in the vein. So what our model does is it tries to teach surgeons the tactile feedback necessary to complete this procedure. This isn't something that you can learn from watching YouTube or talking to some doctors or reading a book possibly. This is something that you have to feel to understand. You have to practice this over and over and over again. Well, where do we go from here? Could you imagine if we could get these into every hospital, every university, anywhere that teaches this procedure? Well, we could really minimize some of the discomfort and some of the complications that the patients would see. And if we could do that for just one patient, well, it would be worth every penny and every second that we put into this 100 times over. Now, I take a lot of pride in what we do here at the JI. We don't do it for us. We do it for you. We do it for the community. More importantly, we do it for everybody that's been affected by vascular disease. Welcome to the new Buffalo. This is the Buffalo that's going to be the gold standard in endovascular care. The Buffalo that's going to change the world. And we have front row seats to a medical revolution right now. So if you guys think this is great, just wait till you see what the JI has planned for the future. Now, on that note, I'd like to pass the mic off to my colleague Brett, who's going to tell you how we can make our models even better. Thank you.
Two pretty good presentations, huh? So, what's next? So today I'm going to talk to you guys about flow. What's the importance of flow? So when I first got to the JI here, my first encounter with flow was the coffee machine. So when you press coffee, it gives you a cup of coffee, except this one gives you half a cup. Well, I want a full cup. So let's take a step back in the history of stroke care. We go back 20 years ago, and this revolutionary drug called TPA came out that changed the game. It was the gold standard, and still is seen as the gold standard in certain instances. So what it does is you inject it in your arm, and it busts a clot. It dissolves it, which sounds great, right? Stroke over. Problem with that. So if you get a stroke, say you're at home alone, and you're sitting there for an hour, and you're like, oh, yeah, she's not feeling well. Hour and a half, 2 hours, and you said, okay, I need to get to the hospital. By the time you get to the hospital, it's been 3 hours, and well, you can't really get the drug after 3 hours or so. So there's a problem with that, and that's what the JI hopes to solve, is the advances in endovascular care here are revolutionary and are changing how we do these procedures here. So what are my interests? I'm a senior in electrical engineering at UB, and what can I bring to the JI? So part of my reason for wanting to be here is, as Matt said, this is just a whole new world Buffalo is bringing to the endovascular care field. So if you think about it, stroke is a lack of blood flow, and a body is like a circuit. So what is a stroke? It cuts that circuit off. And that raises my interest into the JI and stroke as a whole. So let's talk about our models, as if you haven't heard how great they are enough. So here we have some physicians and medical residents testing out the models. Next, they can do pre-surgical planning. So in pre-surgical planning, they can plan what devices what they want. So think about the old saying, time is money. In a stroke, time is brain. So say they go into a procedure, and on the left, you'll see the aortic arch at the bottom going up to the carotid arteries and the brain. So think about when they're going into procedure, and they take a device.
They go up there, and they go, oh, device is too small. Well, first off, they just wasted money on that device. And second off, they just wasted all that time in the patient. So from those two points of view, you get a better way to do it with these models by practicing beforehand. So what do they practice with? Well, here's a company that came to practice one of their medical devices. And so we can do product testing because we have a realistic model. So here's some of the devices that they might test. On the left, we have a stent, which opens up your artery. Aspiration catheter next, which would suck the blood clot out. Next, you'd have a stent retriever that you would go in and you'd embed itself in the clot and pull it out. You'll see a video of that soon. And lastly, you'll see a balloon catheter, which expands and contracts to open up a narrowing in an artery. So think about something like that balloon catheter. It opens up and it deflates. So if it opens up, that's going to cut off blood flow. Say it opens up too fast and deflates too slowly. If you're in someone, that's going to cut off blood flow, and that's not good. So there is a gap there. What is a good enough device to use, and how do you quantify something like that? So that's the gap we're trying to solve here at the JI, and what I was trying to task to do this summer. How do you know when you've cut off too much flow using a device, and how do you know how well a device worked? So that's the gap I'm trying to bridge between qualitative and quantitative. So what do I mean by quantitative? What can we do in our models now? So first off, they're geometrically accurate. What you're going to be practicing on is what you would see in an actual patient, the actual human anatomy of what they have. So say a patient's a little older, they have some type of disease, we can print different materials to account for a buildup in an artery or a narrowing in an artery. And so what else might we care about in the models? Well, something like temperature. So some of these medical devices use a material called nitinol, which is a memory wire. So I have a video here. Pouring a different temperature water on it, and it goes back to its original memory shape. So something like that, if you want to test it in a model there, it's going to be pretty important. So what else do we have? Pressure, force, strain, and flow. So all very important, but I chose to focus on flow for the fact that stroke is a lack of flow. And so here's a little better example of what our models do. And here you'll see a little animation of a stent retriever removing a blood clot. So you'll see the blood clot there, and a removal, and there's an instant regain of flow. So that works great. But a better way to do it would be a way of quantifying that. So how well did it work, and what can you do to improve such a device? Maybe there's a gap between what a physician might prefer. So a preferred certain device, it takes out that feeling of which device the doctor might think would work better. So what do they do now when analyzing how well a procedure went? They use these scales, and there's either 0 to 3 or 0 to 5 scales that say, okay, 0, no flow, okay, 3, 5, good flow. and they're called the Timmy, Tibby, and Ticky scales. So I'll give you an example of one of the scales here. And on the left, you'll see an arrow pointing to a little slight gray area down there. And on the right, you'll see a whole lot more color there. So these are the same pictures on the same patient before and after the procedure. So on the left, you'll see no flow. On the right, you'll see the clot was removed and flow is returned. So as I said before, what's the difference between not enough flow and too much flow? So clearly on the left, you see there's not enough flow going. But on the right, how do we recreate those conditions in the human body that would say, okay, this is a realistic flow for what might be there? So that brings us to, what are you going to do? Well, let's put a flow sensor on our models. And it sounds like a simple task. So say, okay, just put something on there. But as any problem, you go to Google. So you Google units of measurement, and you get liquid flow meter or gas flow meter. Then you go into there, and you get all these different types of flow meters. And if you keep going, you get all of these. And people aren't just making flow meters for no reason. They all have a certain purpose. And whether it's used more commonly than others, they're all used for some reason. So what do you use in a patient-specific neurological model? Well, that's what I was trying to find out here, because not many people are doing things like this, as I said. This is a unique situation. So what do we need in our models here? Well, the beauty of them is that they are anatomically correct. So we don't want to have to mess with the actual model itself to put a flow sensor in. So that knocks out a few of them here. So that leaves us with a few options here that I'll get to in a little bit. So when I say we don't want to mess with the actual model itself, I want to focus on the bottom right in the chart there. So when I say non-intrusive and non-invasive, first off, it is not going to actually touch the liquid inside, and it's also not going to mess with the tubing of the actual model. So something like in the top right there where you see it embeds itself and the tubing has changed its shape, that is not what we want, because that would change the actual flow in the model that we're trying to measure itself. So here's a little more visual. So an insertion type flow meter, think of a meat thermometer where you're sticking it right inside. And if you're sticking something like that inside a model, well, that's gonna break probably. So where would this go? So think about it this way. You would have to poke something inside there, and while you're using a different material, it's not gonna flow the same way. Flow is gonna be changed because you're introducing something into the model that shouldn't be there. And then something like this. Well, that's not the 3D printed material that we know feels right and during the procedure that you would want to do. And even further, when you're designing the model, you'd have to take into account where you would put that in line, and it's a whole other step that you don't want to use. So you want to have something completely outside. And here's a few technologies that can do that. So on top, we have a laser Doppler. So think of when you're going to the doctor, you have that little red light on your finger when you're going to the hospital. It's a pulse oximeter, so it measures, it sends light through your fingers, and the reflection back measures your oxygen levels. So it seems like it can measure flow if it's measuring something in your blood, but it only goes right below your finger into your capillaries, so it doesn't have the penetration you would need for something in this case. And here's how this works. So as the flow speeds up, the wavelength decreases. As the flow speeds down, the wavelength increases. And in these cases, we're not actually measuring flow. We're measuring something that we know we can change, and that can be directly proportional to flow. So take that in the next example, is an electromagnetic sensor. On the top and the bottom, you have two magnets that produce a magnetic field. So when you think of magnets, think positive and negative. So we're going to have to use a conductive fluid in our models to actually do this. And this is actually invasive based on the two electrodes on the side. So you have positive and negative particles, and they're going to be moving through the tube. And as they move, the magnetic field is going to push them to the side. And as they push to the side, they create a voltage on the electrodes. And that voltage that you're measuring on the electrodes is proportional to the flow. So the laser Doppler doesn't get the deep enough penetration, and the electromagnetic, we don't use conductive fluid really, and it's going to be invasive and change the actual tubing. So that brings me to ultrasound. How ultrasound works is place catch. So say I'm standing in front of you, I throw you a ball, you throw it back. Okay, we know how long that took. Now put a wind at my back. I throw you a ball, you throw it back. How fast did it change? It got faster when it went to you, but it got slower when it went back. So that change in time is directly proportional to the flow, as you'll see here. So when you think of ultrasound, you think of a clinical machine. You go to the hospital, you get a sonogram, you have a baby, you're getting something checked for like a stroke or something like that. And so that was my first idea. Let's use a clinical ultrasound machine and put it on one of our models. So that's what I did. I met with Dr. Penelope Lima in the emergency medical department, and she specializes in ultrasound. So the problem with ultrasound is it can't go through air. So you need to embed it in something to reduce those air gaps. So first off, we put it in water. And next, we tried Jell-O. So that's what we did. And here's what you might see in under ultrasound, a carotid artery. So there's a lot going on here. Say someone just wants to take a quick measurement, there's a whole lot they have to do. So picture them holding something like this on a model, and they have to hold it steady, they have to know where they want to measure, and they have to change a lot of settings to get that actual image. Not the most user-friendly experience. So what else can you do? They have different technology and a clamp-on sensor. So I have a clamp-on sensor over here that would go right on the model like this. So what this does is, instead of a linear probe that you would see in the clinical machine that shoots out a bunch of waves at once, this sends four out. So picture four people in an X playing catch, and you'd measure the difference in those times, and you get a flow measurement. So, sounds great. It's a lot better user experience because they give you a little box like this, and this is the flow meter. So, measure the flow, just give you a number. Simple, right? So, but there are limitations. You have something this size, it can't fit everywhere on the model. So, where would something like this go? It could fit, say, here and here, based on what kind of or what size you would buy on the model. But if you buy it for that size, it wouldn't fit here and here or here and here, which could be okay for settings like this, where this is in a straight line, and in a straight line, the flow is going to be the same in both places. But if you get to a more complex model like this, where you have many bifurcations and trifurcations, then, well, either you're going to need a lot more sensors based on where your clot is, and a lot more sensors drives up the cost. So if you go back to the clinical machine, my thought was you could build a user interface to simplify that model. So future work can be done in that regards, but overall, ultrasound is going to be the best way to measure flow in these models. So what's next? There's all these other measurements that still need to be taken here. And that's the beauty of the JI, that there's always these new steps that are taken to improve the endovascular care. So pressure, strain, force, and temperature. So if you're looking for an internship next summer, we have a lot more measurements that need to be taken, and this could be for you. So again, as I said, that's the beauty of a JI. It's an innovation center. So when I'm here having lunch with all these people, I met with Dr. Hopkins one day, and he's the founder of the Jacobs Institute. And he's had a long career and done a lot of things, but people weren't always so open to his ideas. People would always be like, ah, you're crazy, you can't do that. And well, he did. Here we are, the JI. And that's the openness to innovation here you see it. Not only the JI, but the Niagara Medical Campus as a whole. So with that being said, the JI put together a team of me, Matt, and Tessa here. You have an electrical engineer and myself, a mechanical engineer and Matt, and a biomedical engineer and Tessa. You get these diverse people coming together in one place, and you produce great things like all of our projects here, the past intern projects, and the future ones that are here to come. So even high school interns came, and the presentations they had were unbelievable. Like, I can't believe these kids are at a junior and senior level just coming to a place just to brainstorm and innovate. And with that being said, I'd like to thank everyone for their time here, and I'd like to invite Matt and Tessa up for questions.
Carry on the Jacobs Institute dream, but I think people would be interested. I'm going to be a senior at UB, so I'm going to go back and finish out my bachelor's degree in biomedical engineering, and then after this I hope to go on to grad school.
And I'm going to finish up my degree at NCCC, and then I really want to stay in the biomedical engineering field. It's very, very rewarding.
Yeah, same as Tessa, except I'll be in electrical engineering, and I'm finishing up my senior year and want to go on to graduate school.
Question for Matt?
Yes.
I don't need it. I'll speak very loudly. I thought that was fascinating. Have you given any thought, or has anybody given some thought to how you extend that training opportunity beyond entry into the femoral model? Because that is sometimes successful, and the real damage is done after the artery is entered, but before you get to the heart of the brain.
Yes, we actually had some recommendations from the fellows and the surgeons to do a radial access model as well, because quite often that is one of the spots that they're going to use nowadays, and it's gaining a lot of traction. So we feel that would be a very helpful model as well to be able to create to, you know, ease that process, that training procedure.
That goes to the entry, but my question really is beyond entry and until you get to either the brain or the heart, the next 2 feet or 3 feet.
Yeah.
That would definitely be something we'd be able to do, to be connecting our models, and you know, then we'd be able to do our aortic models, tie them into our intracranial models, and then finally down to our puncture models. So ideally, we could be able to create the entire procedure from entry to the work that they're doing up in the brain or the heart, to the tool removals, and even the closure procedures.
I'm good too. Tremendous work, and sounds like just a phenomenal place here. Sure, coming in, you didn't know what you were going to experience. What was the coolest, or what was the most dramatic thing that you saw or were exposed to? Not necessarily your work, but just this experience.
Brain surgery, no doubt.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yeah.
One time, Matt and I were kind of brainstorming. I kind of tagged along for a lot of his projects, because it was really cool. He was looking at how to make his model feel very lifelike, like you were touching an actual human body. And upstairs in the UB Research Centers, they actually have a pig lab. So Matt walked up there one day and was like, hey, like, can we come get some pig samples? So Matt and I went up there and we got actual pig flesh from one that they had recently put down, and we brought it back down to the JI and put it in our fridge.
For me, one of the coolest parts was actually down in the cath labs. During one of the procedures, it was really kind of a humbling experience to see the patient on the table, and then when the surgeon was done saying, all right, you're all set, just how grateful he was, because these patients are, you know, fully awake, and he was thanking the surgeon, but not for himself, which was what really got me. He was thanking the surgeon for his family, so that was kind of like an emotional, like, wow moment. So that was that's really going to stick with me.
Questions. I have a.
Don't leave, Tessa.
A little something.
Am I going down here? Oh wait, where's the mouse?
You can pick it up. You can pick
it up. I don't want it to start yet.
Great, so I'm Allison Kupferman, the Manager of Communications and Outreach at the Jacobs Institute, and wow, Team Science, this is amazing, so congratulations to you guys. Uh, These are really impressive projects done by very remarkable interns, and we couldn't be prouder. They've worked really, really hard to make this quite a production today. This year, we had 45 applicants from 10 schools across the Eastern Seaboard. And from there, we selected Maddie, T-Bird, and Bebo. And how lucky we are to have discovered these talented engineers. Our interns always hold a special place in our hearts, and as a matter of fact, we have a couple of past interns in the audience, so if you guys could just kind of stand and wave and show everyone that you've still been here, you know, you're still connected to us. Great. So we're ecstatic to add Tessa, Matt, and Brett to these outstanding alumni. And I always put together a little something to remind them of their summer spent here with us at the Jacobs Institute. Lunch and learns with professionals from the Buffalo Niagara Medical Campus, running the corporate challenge, a dinner graciously hosted by one of our board members, Mr. Beecher, working on their projects, of course, and general good times. So interns, here is your summer 2017. I did that very dramatically, so let's hope this works. Is that working? I'm sorry. I'm having technical difficulties. Tessa has been our AV guru, so. Ah, there we go.
I've been reading books of old, the legends and the myths, Achilles and his gold, Achilles and his gifts, Spider-Man's control, and Batman and his fist. And clearly I don't see myself upon that list. She said, where'd you wanna go? How much you wanna risk? I'm not looking for somebody with some superhuman gifts, some superhero, some fairy tale bliss, just something I can turn to, somebody I can kiss. I want something just like this.
Great. Well, thanks, everybody. Congratulations.
Now let's go party across the way and celebrate them. You can see some of their models.